Welcome everyone to the 19th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee 2022. I've received no apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed, thank you. And our second item today is the first formal evidence session as part of our inquiry into health inequalities. This session will focus on progress in addressing and tackling health inequalities in Scotland since 2015, when our predecessor committee published a report on this topic. Before we start, I would like to take this opportunity to thank everyone who took part in our informal evidence sessions on last Friday and yesterday. The evidence we heard at those sessions will feed into formal evidence session to take place on the 14th of June, but don't be surprised if it comes up throughout all our evidence sessions. Very, very powerful testimony from people with lived experience. But thank Claire Stevens for organising a lot of the people that we spoke to. Their voices, the voices of people, really need to be heard. So I would imagine that regardless of the session, that people will be making reference, albeit names redacted, to some of the things that we heard, particularly from the people who feel they have a lack of access to healthcare. But I welcome to the committee this morning David Finch, the Assistant Director for Healthy Lives Directorate of the Health Foundation, who's attending online. I believe he's had a little bit of difficulty getting online, so hopefully as I speak it's happening. Jerry McCartney, Professor of Wellbeing Economy for the University of Glasgow, who's attending in person. Claire Stevens, as I said, Chief Executive of Voluntary Health Scotland, who helped us organise our informal sessions, attending in person. And David Walsh, Public Health Programme Manager for the Glasgow Centre for Population Health, who's also joining us online. So good morning to you all. I was going to ask all of you about the progress that's been made since 2015, and I do want that in the back of your minds. I know you've all got an opening statement, but I just want to say up front, health inequalities is a massive subject, and I think it would be really remiss of this committee if all we did was talk about the problems. I really want this inquiry to be looking at how we can find solutions and actions and recommendations that we can make in areas of devolved competence where we can. So with that in mind, I'll start with your opening statements. And can if is David Finch on? No, he's not yet. So I'll go to Jerry first of all then.
Thank you, convener, and thank you to the committee for inviting me to come along. To build on the point that you've made, health inequalities are arguably one of the biggest challenges that Scotland faces. Health inequalities here are wider than anywhere else in Western or Central Europe and have been growing over the last 10 years. And that widening in health inequalities has been particularly stark since around 2012. Since that date, we've seen that mortality rates amongst the poorest 30 or 40% of areas have actually worsened in real terms in the run-up to the pandemic, and of course were then subsequently exacerbated by the pandemic. So we should be under no illusions about the lack of progress towards narrowing health inequalities and the challenge that we face. You've rightly, I think, asked us to think of some of the things that have happened that have been helpful over that time, and I wanted to highlight three things that I think have made a difference to mitigate that stark problem that I've outlined. The first is the introduction of the Scottish Child Payment. So we know that health inequalities are due to inequalities in income, wealth and power in society, and because those income inequalities, wealth inequalities and power inequalities have continued to widen, that's why health inequalities have continued to widen. But the Scottish Child Payment starts to mitigate some of the rises in child poverty that we've seen and makes it less bad than it would otherwise have been. And that's important because mitigation, you know, can make a difference. I think it is also worth mentioning the furlough scheme. So had it not been for the furlough scheme, people would have been just without incomes for a prolonged period of time during the pandemic. And so that's been a saviour. And I think it's important that we recognise that. And then there are other things, particularly when we know about rising costs for people, that have reduced those costs. So things like free bus travel for some groups, free prescriptions, free school meals for some groups. These do reduce the costs that are faced by families. And so that's important as well, at reducing the sort of real effect of poverty in people's lives. But there have been a wide range of unhelpful policies, particularly on the sort of macroeconomic scale, that have driven these inequalities in income, wealth and power. And not many of these are within devolved competence, if we're honest about it. So we've continued to have an economic design that drives widening economic inequalities, and that in consequence causes health inequalities to widen. And arguably, I think we've been a little bit distracted at times with specific policies to address health inequalities over the last, you know, 10 or 20 years. So we've had policies like Keep Well that haven't been found to be effectual at reducing health inequalities. We've had a reliance on improvement science approaches and the collaboratives to reduce health inequalities, and these haven't addressed the fundamental causes and, again, haven't been proven to make a difference. And there's also a sort of vogue at the moment for place-based approaches, which I don't hold much hope for, because they don't address the gradient. So even if they're focused on the most deprived areas, the health inequalities are seen across the entire population, not just in deprived areas. Most deprived individuals don't live in deprived areas, and so it won't target those groups. And it ignores the economic relationship between social groups, instead sort of almost pretending that people's deprivation status is independent of those relationships. So in summary, we need to think about, how do we address the economic design of the country that leads to widening income, wealth and power inequalities? But we also know from a big review done by NHS Health Scotland a number of years ago about the other policies that work to reduce health inequalities. And that invariably are the kinds of policies that don't rely on individual agency. So things that involve taxation, regulation and legislation. And we've seen really good examples of that in Scotland with minimum unit pricing, the ban on discount buys for alcohol, the ban on smoking in public places. These are good examples. But we've got other areas that we need to think about. What about the food system, for example, and what that does to drive an obesity environment and the rise in obesity in Scotland.
Thank you very much, Jerry. Can I come to Claire Stevens?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody, and thank you for this opportunity to contribute to the inquiry and to have been involved in helping shape the informal events that took place on Friday and Monday. So my organisation, Voluntary Health Scotland, we're a national intermediary and network for health charities and other voluntary organisations involved in health in the widest sense, so a lot of community development organisations, for example. But our core purpose really is to work with member organisations and other stakeholders to try to address health inequalities and to create better health and wellbeing for all people and communities. And for the past 7 years, we've also been the secretariat for the Cross-Party Group on Health Inequalities here. And that's a CPG with over 90 external organisational members and 5 MSPs at the moment, and actually a mailing list of over 300 additional people. So it's a very well-supported cross-party group. But if I reflect back to 2015, which is the time of your original or earlier inquiry, that was the year that my organisation first really started to get involved in looking at health inequalities. And we conducted research and published research that we called Living in the Gap, a voluntary health sector perspective on health inequalities in Scotland. And that report described the widening health inequalities gap from our sector standpoint, giving an insight into people's real lived experience and describing the wide range of positive approaches and interventions that voluntary organisations undertake to mitigate inequalities and to try and prevent and reduce, but largely to mitigate inequalities. And we followed up with a second report, the Zuberi report, in 2018, which this time focused on the lived experience of loneliness and social isolation, mindful of Glasgow Centre for Population Health's findings that lower levels of social capital and community connectedness are associated with higher levels of health inequalities. And I mention these reports because their findings are as valid today as they were when published 7 years ago, except that, as Jerry has said, the gap is widening, not narrowing, and any green shoots are in danger of being cut down by the pandemic and the growing poverty crisis. I was reading some of the written responses that you've had to the inquiry and was struck by Diabetes Scotland pointing out that people in Scotland's most deprived areas will spend half of their lives in poor health, 24 years more than people in the most affluent areas. So throughout the last 7 years, our sector, the third sector, has continued to mitigate these impacts by providing targeted services and support, tackling social isolation, loneliness and stigma. We heard a lot about stigma over the last 2 days. Building social capital through community development and place-based work, and homing in on those who've been simply left behind or overlooked by public policy and services. But voluntary organisations also work upstream, carrying out research campaigns and education to help improve law, policy and practice, and playing key roles in local and national partnerships and community empowerment. And they do all of this without reliable or sustainable funding for a great deal of the time, and in the face of growing demands and needs, and not least during this continuing phase of the pandemic. So the kinds of upstream strategies that our sector wants to see include investment in wellbeing communities to build, sustain and protect durable community assets, compassionate, non-stigmatising and humane public services, high quality, secure, affordable housing, improved access and support to use green and communal spaces for those facing the greatest barriers, easy access to healthy, affordable food, improved digital connectivity and affordability for those least able to access it, much more accessible and affordable public transport, measures focused on food, tobacco and alcohol to help prevent unnecessary deaths from non-communicable diseases, proportionate universalism and active outreach to ensure services are reaching those missing from services or furthest away, and above all, across government strategy centred on ending poverty. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Claire. And I'll come to David Walsh. David.
Thank you and good morning. The danger of going last or almost last, which is a hazard of having a surname that begins with W, is that you end up sometimes repeating what you've already heard. So I might repeat some of Jerry's points to a degree here. But I'll just try and make four very quick points, and they all relate to the important issue, which I think is important to be clear about, that there's actually no mystery about the causes of and the solutions to health inequalities. At the risk of sounding Rumsfeld-esque, there are more knowns than unknowns in this area. So I'm going to very quickly give you four knowns. The first is that we know very well about the horrific scale and the adverse trends in health inequalities, as Jerry mentioned, even before the changes of the last 10 years, which I'll say a bit more about, and before the pandemic, we had the widest health inequalities in Western Europe. But those inequalities, again, as Jerry alluded to, have exacerbated massively since about 2012. The second known, which is really important, is we know very clearly why. We know why we have wide health inequalities generally, and we know why they have widened so much in the last 10 years. Health inequalities are an extension of wider societal inequalities, socioeconomic inequalities. If you have a country with a wide wealth gap, you have a country with a wide health gap. And Scotland, like the rest of the UK, has seen since 1979 a massive widening of socioeconomic inequalities, and at the same time, as a clear consequence, a massive widening of health inequalities. The two go hand in glove. But in the last 10 years, with the UK government's implementation of the austerity programme, which has slashed literally tens of billions of pounds from the income of the poorest and the most vulnerable in society, we have, scandalously in my opinion, seen these increasing death rates in the poorest communities up and down the UK, and as a consequence, a widening of inequalities. And actually what we have now is a new form of inequality, in the sense that previously health inequalities widened because the health of the better off improved faster than the health of the less well off. But importantly, the health of the less well off was still improving. The impact of austerity is now that the health of the less well off is actually getting worse. So we have a new form of widening inequality. The third known is, as important as knowing why we have wide health inequalities, we also know what we need to do about them. As Jerry alluded to, there's a lot of international evidence of the correct policies out there. And indeed, the Scottish Government commissioned Health Scotland, which is now Public Health Scotland, to undertake a review a few years ago of the international evidence of what works and what doesn't work to narrow health inequalities. So it's all there. It's all published in black and white for people to look at. That review talked about the need to address inequalities at three levels. First and foremost, to address those fundamental socioeconomic inequalities in society, the wealth gap. Secondly, as Gerry alluded to, what they referred to as sort of wider environmental influences. So that's about housing and pollution and alcohol pricing and all these things. And there's also issues around individual experiences of inequalities. But the most important sentence in that report was the one that said, if you don't do the first, if you don't narrow socioeconomic inequalities in society, you will not succeed in narrowing health inequalities. And so my fourth and final point is that's really, really important to understand. And it's also really, really problematic for Scotland. Because to narrow those socioeconomic inequalities, we obviously need the relevant powers. And in Scotland, we have some powers, so we can change income tax rates and bans. We have a very small number of social security powers. But it remains the case that the vast majority of taxation, as Gerry mentioned, of social security, of other relevant legislative areas like employment law, all remains reserved to Westminster. So there are some really great things that we can do in Scotland, and they've been alluded to by the other two people in the committee. And there's things that we have done that we should be very proud of. But the problem is it's an issue of balance. So on the one hand, if you do all these kind of great things, and then the UK government comes along and takes tens of billions of pounds from the income of the poorest and the most vulnerable in society, then what happens? The bad outweighs the good. So I think there's a need for honesty in the situation about understanding the constraints that we're in. That realistically, in Scotland, we're not going to narrow health inequalities unless either we have additional powers around those socioeconomic areas or if there's a change of policy direction at Westminster. So I think it's important in formulating recommendations, be that from this committee or from David Finch's Health Foundation review that's happening at the moment, to understand that reality about what we are able to do. Thanks.
Thank you, David. And we now have David Finch has been able to join us. David, we're just at the point where people are giving opening statements, so I would like to ask you for yours. Thank you. No, we can't hear David, so maybe we might have to go audio only. Maybe if it's some just speaking through the ether to broadcasting, maybe if we put David on audio only, we might have a fighting chance of hearing him.
Can you
yes,
hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you now. On you go, David.
Great. Thank you. I think I had the wrong microphone attached to the thing. So thank you for inviting me to speak today. I think the Health Foundation is a really independent charity aiming to improve health and reduce health inequalities. We undertake a range of different activities, from kind of giving grants, working on the front line through to funding research and policy analysis. We're currently carrying out an independent review of health and health inequalities in Scotland. And through that review, we're really aiming to provide a detailed analysis of health trends and social economic factors that influence health. We're really trying to understand why, because we recognise that there's already significant historical work in the area and already significant policy. It's trying to understand why, despite that, we still see health inequalities persisting. Our past research, which includes a 10-year-old update to the Marmot Review and our COVID impact inquiry, has often highlighted how it's how people's health is influenced by the conditions in which people are kind of born and live and grow, and also their experiences in their day-to-day lives. So that's something we think will definitely be key themes through the review we're currently supporting. But really want to make sure that that's considering issues specific to Scotland. Also, really trying to go beyond the islands and capturing both people who are working on the front line, people within policy and delivery roles, and also through some public engagement, so we get a really rounded picture of what's happening. We're certainly come into this very open-minded and have no really like preconceived ideas about where we think the review will end and the findings that will come out. We very much want to be driven by or led by the findings coming through from the different research strands we're funding and also our advisory group. And we've tried quite hard to make sure those are very much grounded within Scotland. We have four kind of key strands of research funding. One is looking at public health trends and is being led by Anna Pearce at the University of Glasgow. The second one is looking at the social and economic factors that are public health, and that's being led by David Iser at the Fraser Allender Institute. And then we also have two other strands, which one really trying to engage with stakeholders both in the kind of policy and delivery sphere, and really that's being led by Adam Lang at Nesta, and then also a strand of deliberative public engagement, which is being led by Mark Diffley at the Diffley Partnership. And so we're really hoping that those strands all kind of form together and are really informing each other through the process. And we're planning for those to start to be published in the autumn with a final report of our own set for the kind of following that, which gives like an overview of the findings and will hopefully give some indications of where we think there are key priority areas for policy. I would just like to finish by saying that you know, we're very keen with this review is able to help inform the work of the committee and whether that's sharing our emerging findings, helping to inform some of your policy recommendations and particularly where there are areas of interest that being highlighted through your work and through the inquiry that maybe things that we should take a look at with more of a priority as we are, as the review keeps developing. Thank you.
Thank you, David. And you'll notice we've put you on audio only. Your signal improved quite a bit, so we might not be able to see you, but we can certainly now hear you fine. Just a little bit of housekeeping. Those that are joining us online, the two Davids, if you want to come in on anything specifically, put an R in the chat box and my clerk will let me know that you want to come in. I want to pick up on a couple of things that's been said in your opening remarks. Jerry, you said about the place-based approach. I want to delve a little bit deeper into your thoughts on that, saying that, you know, that putting this place-based approach might not actually, to your mind, have the effect perhaps that thinking about, because we're hearing an awful lot about this from government ministers, but also from commentators more generally. Can you expand on that?
Yeah, so it's a bit of an ill-defined approach, if we're honest, but if it means focusing on the areas that are the most deprived and have the worst health outcomes, which I take it to mean in most occasions, then what that would not do is address the gradient in health inequality. So even if you had a set of effective interventions that can be carried out at a small community level, and notwithstanding what we've already discussed in terms of the biggest drivers of health inequality, so that in itself seems unlikely to be effective. But even if that were to be effective and that was to improve the health of the small communities who are living in, or the people that are living in the most deprived areas, that wouldn't by definition address the gradient. So it occurs across all of Scotland, all of society, all of the UK. And so we need, as I think Claire referred to, a sort of proportional universal approach whereby effective interventions are introduced that impact most in the deprived areas, but have an impact across that gradient in proportion to need. And so for that reason, I think it's unlikely to be effective. But there are also other sort of more technical reasons about the fact that most deprived individuals don't live in the most deprived areas. So if you look at income deprivation and employment deprivation, for example, only a very small proportion of the Scottish population who are individually income or employment deprived live in the, for example, the 20% most deprived areas. And so if you simply target those areas with interventions, you'll miss the vast majority of people who need them. And then it sort of refers back to the fundamental causes. So the causes of health inequalities are the social and economic relationships between social groups, and a place-based approach doesn't look at that in any way, shape or form. So I worry that a lot of energy and attention goes into a place-based approach that ultimately will look back in 10 years' time and it will be another keep well, it will be another sort of failed, very specific health inequalities approach, when in fact what we really need is an inequalities approach for Scotland that addresses inequalities in the round and health inequalities. If an inequalities general approach is effective, then that will generate a narrowing in health inequalities specifically.
And Claire, you mentioned about I've written your quote down. Those that have been left behind or overlooked by public policy and services. I think we heard from a lot of those groups in our two sessions. And I wonder if you identify, certainly in the two sessions that we had some marginalised groups, a lot of them with no recourse to public funds. Would you be able to expand on that? Who was in your mind when you thought policies and services are not getting to these people or not taking these people into account? And which policies, which services, I suppose I'm asking?
I think there's a wide range of groups, and we saw, you know, a cross section of some of those over the last 2 days. But I suppose, some people from Black and ethnic minority communities, people living in deep poverty, gypsy travellers, some disabled people. So that those sorts of groups, I think, were represented at the two sessions yesterday, and also across our sort of network. But there was Dr. Andrea Williamson has done interesting work, I think a colleague now of Jerry's at Glasgow University and a DPEN GP, looking at what she calls the missing in health. So it's those patients who should be patients of primary care who don't turn up to appointments or don't take advantage of screening and so on. So why don't they come forward? It's because the NHS is a universal service that expects people to turn up and just take advantage of it. But without the sort of targeted outreach or proportionate universalism reaching out to people, some people face such barriers that it's just difficult for them to take advantage of that. If there's time later on, I'd quite like to talk about our work in helping make the COVID vaccine programme more inclusive, because I think that's quite a good example of that. Can I just comment briefly on what Jerry said on place-based approaches? Because I agree with Jerry entirely at one level, but on the other hand, I suppose for my sector and for 40,000 voluntary organisations across Scotland, the vast majority of those work in a single community, not even across a whole local authority. So they're getting in at the deep end, at the grassroots. They are reaching communities that are often marginalised or are furthest away from public services for whatever reason. They're gaining the trust and confidence of those and working with them. So that's very place-based, and there isn't enough investment in that sort of work. And I think the other element that has been missing from our very important discussion so far about the economy and about wealth is about where people with lived experience themselves sit in all of this. So, involving people in the co-design and the co-development of services, for example, empowering people, and that has to be done at a place-based community level often. And again, I've got examples from our own work. For example, we sit on the Scottish Government's Primary Care Health Inequalities Development Group that reported earlier this year. And its work was looking at the recovery of primary care and what do GPs and other primary care practitioners have to do to overcome the health inequalities in their communities and reach the people who are missing from their practices at the moment. But the process that the group went through involved a group of lived experience being involved and checking every step of the way with that. And that was through Dr. Peter Causton, who's a DPEN GP in Glasgow. So I think it's something about we need top-down measures, as we've heard very powerfully already this morning, but that there has to be something coming from the grassroots as well, and something that works with people where they are and isn't doing to people but is doing with people.
We heard in informal sessions of very strongly, don't just consult us, involve us in the decision making, and what you've said there about actually almost kind of road testing things with focus groups from people that your decisions are going to affect was absolutely important. Can I come to David Walsh? And sorry, I'm just picking up a couple of things before I open it up to my colleagues. David, you talked about mitigation measures and you talked about the issues that you've got when you have got things out with your control having an impact on your spending. You talked about austerity measures in particular. I just what a sense of austerity measures obviously put in place by those who thought they were a good idea were to save money. But what is the long-term cost of austerity measures when you look at what you just said about the impact on the health of people? And where does the Scottish Government sit in terms of mitigation with a fixed budget?
Well, that's a great question. So the Scottish Government has done good things. So at the start of austerity, when the bedroom tax came in, the Scottish Government basically made up for that through discretionary housing payments to help with that. As Gerry mentioned, they've brought in a new social security payment, the Scottish Child Payment, for those on low income. But again, it comes back to what I said about a balance. You know, there's things that Scotland can do and have done. But the sheer scale of things in terms of the scale of austerity means that these good things are kind of dwarfed by the negatives. We're publishing a report next week with the University of Glasgow and Gerry about all the evidence of what austerity has done in terms of overall health and health inequalities. So the evidence, is all there in black and white in terms of the scale of it, in terms of the cuts to people's incomes, in terms of the loss of services, in terms of how that's affected people through lots of different pathways, though increasing levels of poverty. There's evidence there, not just in relation to poverty rates, but in terms of the relationship between austerity and food banks provision, homelessness, how austerity has impacted on increased levels of mental health. There are clear links, again, evidenced for the links between mental health and physical health, etc. So you can trace the effects of austerity through well-understood pathways to ultimately, and tragically, early death. So your question about what's the cost of austerity, the costs are horrendous. There have been some studies trying to quantify this in numbers of deaths, and we're doing a bit of work around that, but it's horrific. And again, just to come back to the issue of that the cost of life, if you like, and the financial cost. If you think about the amount of money that was invested in response to the pandemic correctly, that came about because of modelling, which showed that if the UK government did nothing about COVID, we'd have 500,000 deaths in the country, which was just a terrifying figure. Other research that we've published with colleagues, again at Glasgow University, has shown that 500,000 deaths is more or less what you get from inequalities in the UK every couple of years. So it's about understanding the scale, and therefore, if we can find lots and lots of money to deal with one crisis, then I think we need to find the money to deal with a much longer lasting crisis that's having a bigger effect. And to make the obvious final point is that the UK and Scotland are wealthy countries. It's about the distribution of that wealth across the country and the extent to which it helps the poorest and those who need the most help.
Thank you. Sandesh, you wanted to come in, I believe.
Well, I just wanted to clarify. Gerry, you said employment deprived. And I don't understand that term, so I was wondering if you could clarify that for me, please.
Of course. So the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation has, I think, several domains, 4, 5, 6, two of which are about income deprivation and employment deprivation. So it's about the number of people within each local area who claim unemployment-related benefits. So it actually underestimates the true deprivation of employment opportunity within areas because it's only about those that claim it, but it's what's used to rank small areas by terms of deprivation and monitor inequalities and a whole range of outcomes for Scotland.
Sue, you want to come in on this?
Yes, I do. It's interesting, yourself, Claire Stevens, we spoke yesterday in the session, but I was interested in the comments that you're making around the proportionate universalism. And we also hear, and I was interested also with some of the comments you made about Jerry McCartney's colleague, that's the GP in the practice, in terms of how we can do some more targeted approach and how you think that might really drill down and help us, rather than having a universal approach. I think yesterday was the best are able to advocate for themselves and get an unfair share of resources, I think was some of the comments we heard. So I'm interested on your thoughts on that. Thank you. And I am not an expert in proportionate universalism. I suspect Jerry and David know and would be able to explain this far better than me. So my understanding is that with a service like the NHS or indeed education, which is free at the point of delivery and is ostensibly open to all to take it up, the issue is that for some people who face greater barriers to taking up those services, the universal offer isn't as accessible. So that I suppose looking at things like screening, so there is some work going on at the moment, as I understand, I think in North Lanarkshire and West Lothian, looking at cancer bowel screening and how and why that is less taken up by people in more deprived communities. So ostensibly that is open for all people to take up bowel screening, but some people don't. So why don't they, and what might help them to take it up? If I could use the example of the COVID vaccine. So last year, when all the blue envelopes were sort of rolling out and in through people's letterboxes, in December, January, really, as the vaccine programme was just starting, the third sector got quite concerned that there would be all sorts of people who might not have a letterbox for a blue envelope to come through in the first place, because they might be homeless or living in temporary accommodation, or they might not have good levels of literacy, English might not be their first language, they might have serious mental health problems or learning disabilities. So what would actually happen to support people to take up this universal offer that was going to actually not just protect them, but protect the whole of the community? And indeed, we were concerned that the groups who might be least able or likely or hesitant to take up the vaccine would be those at highest risk of COVID. So we did some research across the sector, and we got involved with Public Health Scotland and Scottish Government and what then became the Inclusion Vaccine Programme. But one of the things that the third sector did in Lothian was to work with Edinburgh and Lothian's Health Foundation, so that's the endowment fund part of NHS Lothian, and with NHS Lothian itself, and the four third sector interfaces for the Lothians, to look at what the third sector could do, very grassroots organisations, to actually support people to understand the benefits of the vaccine, to help them understand the communications that were coming out from NHS Inform, because they weren't always easy to understand, and then to actually get to the vaccine. And so in Lothian, they set up a microgrants scheme, and the microgrants scheme funded grassroots organisations to hold events in people's own languages, to perhaps get health experts along to debunk myths about the vaccine, because there were lots of myths and misinformation going about, to help people physically get to vaccination centres, and then in some cases to have outreach to where people were, whether that was homeless shelters or other situations where people actually were. So in a modest sort of way, if you like, from a third sector perspective, that is an example of where we think a targeted approach to a public health intervention was successful. And we think it has all sorts of wider implications. You could involve the third sector in that way with screening, for example. But third sector isn't routinely involved in planning vaccination programmes. But what a difference that might make if they were. Perhaps we could reach more successfully those people in West Lothian and North Lanarkshire who aren't currently taking up bowel screening, for example.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you very much. We've also heard from people today around, you know, our life expectancy. I think Jerry spoke at length about that as well, in terms of that inequality. And we have the lowest life expectancy of the four nations, despite higher public spending. And Scotland and the US are the only two non-Eastern European countries at the very bottom of the life expectancy table. So when you compare us with the other UK nations, you could make the assumption that this is not because of COVID. So I'm just wondering, what do you think might be making our perfect storm of issues in Scotland right now?
Hey, so that's a big question. No. There's layer upon layer of sort of history here. So if you go back to sort of 1950s, Scotland was amongst the average in terms of life expectancy across Europe and other high-income countries. And slowly that began to sort of drift apart, and Scotland's rate of improvement was a little bit slower. But that really became apparent from about the 1980s onwards. That's when the real departure from the European means happened. So David Walsh led a huge programme of work looking at what we call excess mortality, so the higher mortality after accounting for the sort of the socioeconomic circumstances that pertain in Scotland. Some people have termed that the Scottish effect or the Glasgow effect, but we've tried to get rid of that because all that research has now made clear that really it was a political effect. So it was about the decisions that were made over that time period, both in the run-up to the 1980s in terms of urban policy and new towns policy and deindustrialisation, but that was all exacerbated by the change in economic policy that led to the widening of income inequalities and privatisation that we've kind of rehearsed already. So that's the kind of initial phase. Then you have the phase from 2010 onwards of austerity that's widened health inequalities more, and David Walsh has rehearsed that as well. And then, of course, COVID has then impacted on that once again. So we've had sort of three important waves of negative impacts on health.
Can I have one? Just, I suppose what I was trying to say is that the other parts of the United Kingdom have faced the same political policies in terms of austerity, but they're not making the same backwards, not seeing the same regression. So I'm just trying to, you know, in terms of us really drilling down and tackling that inequalities, we heard yesterday that we have wonderful policies, but I don't get a sense that it's really starting to get under the skin and getting down to the ground and implementing and make the differences that we need.
So sorry, I misunderstood the nature of your question.
So it's a long question.
So Scotland has essentially become more vulnerable to these kinds of economic policies. So if, for example, you turn investment away from council housing and you have a higher proportion of council houses as a country, which Scotland had in the 1980s, then you'll be more badly affected than the rest of the UK, for example. If you have a particular industrial structure to your employment and that industrial structure is undermined systematically, then again, you'll lose more jobs and you have worse health impacts. So that's why Scotland deviated from the rest of the UK during that earlier time period. And we see scarring effects of that on people's health now. So drug-related deaths, for example, are in part due to these scarring effects that we've seen 20 and 30 years ago within the population. So all of that leaves the population more vulnerable to these kinds of policies. But I wouldn't be too down on some of the policies that we have introduced, like the ban on smoking in public places and minimum unit pricing. These have made huge differences to outcomes in Scotland. And indeed, also just to refer to some of the stuff in terms of services that Claire's talked through, again, we've resisted a lot of the marketisation that's happened in other parts of the UK, which again gives us a better shouting chance to mitigate health inequalities. So the much quoted Julian Tudor Hart's inverse care law, the bit that's less well quoted around that is that services are not taken up in proportion to need, especially where market forces operate and where there are a number of barriers. So where you see the most equitable uptake of services, so that's where services are uptaken in proportion to need, so people in more deprived circumstances are accessing more because they need more, that's things where there are the least barriers, things like accident and emergency departments. Primary care is somewhere in between, so there are some barriers to people accessing that, and Claire's talked through some of those barriers. But where we have more marketisation of services, even in Scotland, so I'm thinking of dentistry, opticians, physiotherapy, where there's a very limited supply within the NHS, these are much less likely to be taken up in proportion to need, and people in middle classes are more likely to get what they need through those services because of those additional barriers, monetary and otherwise, including all the barriers that Claire's talked through. So it's a complicated mix of history that explains why Scotland does worse, but I don't think we should be too down on the mitigation that we do have in place.
Before I go to Emma Harper for questions, David.
It was just a quick point of clarification. So Jerry's answered the question correctly about historical reasons for Scotland lagging behind other UK nations, but the question also asked about austerity, and I just wanted to make it clear that the effects of austerity have not just been seen in Scotland. So the same issues that we've talked about in terms of increasing death rates among more deprived populations have been shown now in research for England, for Wales and for Northern Ireland. So the same broad, horrific effects of austerity have been seen across the whole of the UK. And I think it's just to be important to be clear about that. Mm.
And I imagine that the point about deindustrialisation, there are certain parts of England and Wales that have been similarly affected, but of course it's maybe not shown up in national data in the same way that it does in Scotland.
Yeah, so we did a huge study a number of years ago looking at deindustrialised regions, not just in the UK, but across Europe. And the general rule is that all post-industrial regions tend to be poorer for lots of historical reasons and therefore tend to have poorer health. But again, it came down to politics. So there's a number of areas in the continent, for example, where the national and local responses to deindustrialisation had basically been a lot better than in the UK, and therefore it protected the population's health. So again, it comes down to different political responses at different layers.
Thank you. Emma.
Thanks, convener. Good morning to you here in person as well as the people on screen here. So just a quick question about upstream causes of health inequalities and the balance between downstream and upstream and how we tackle that. I have a paper here in front of me from the National Institute of Health and Care Research that basically uses the river metaphor to talk about public health. Downstream interventions focus on things like behaviour change and treatments for illnesses, whereas upstream interventions focus on social factors that contribute to health and prevent illness, such as housing, employment and education. So in relating to that, what is the balance between the upstream and the downstream? And I think Claire mentioned that in her opening. Maybe Claire would be the person to ask about that.
Oh, thank you. I don't know that there's an easy answer to where the balance lies at all. I mean, I think the most important means by which to tackle health inequalities is upstream. But I suppose the challenge is that is long term. So getting the political change, getting the change in the economy, getting those sort of measures, the measures that Jerry and David are talking about, it's a long term thing. So you're talking about preventing health inequalities in generations to come. And I suppose, again, for the third sector, for the voluntary sector, our interest is always the here and now and people who are suffering now or who we might be able to help in the here and now, which is why I suppose some of what the third sector is doing is fishing people out of the stream further down. But so a balance, I think, is difficult. But I mean, I think that the third sector has a very keen sense of the need for measures like better housing and employment that is, you know, secure and pays well and doesn't cause stress, of much more affordable and accessible public transport. So those are all political decisions and they make a difference. If you can't afford to get on a bus to get to your appointment to a GP, then you know that is gonna have an impact. And that is something, those sorts of policies should be in the gift of policymakers and decision makers today. Changing the economy is a longer term, it's a harder thing. But I agree absolutely, upstream is where the focus needs to be. And perhaps the difficulty is, you know, you had an inquiry 7 years ago, there was the Ministerial Task Force on Health Inequalities, there was equally, wow, there's been all these different, you know, apparently sort of big programmes designed to address health inequalities. But if they only last the lifetime of a parliament, then they're not going to have that traction and make the difference that we know needs made.
An introduction of the living wage would be one of the policies that's working. As of April 2022, it's £9.50 an hour. Is that something that, basically giving people enough money to manage their families, their homes, that would be part of what would be something that works? Is that a question for Jerry, maybe, or...?
Can I come back briefly on that? There was a very interesting contribution to one of the events. I think it was on Friday. There was somebody from NHS Highland who, on the health improvement side of things, who said, of course, NHS Highland is a living wage employer, and that goes without saying, but that she felt that as an anchor institution, in their community and one of the biggest employers, I think along with the local authority, they are the biggest employers in Highland. They could be doing much more to promote the living wage to other employers, which I thought was a really interesting take on it. But I think also in those sessions we heard that, you know, that the living wage alone isn't enough, because actually if you're an unpaid carer, for example, or, you know, you're disabled, you've got extra costs then, or other sort of health conditions or other things going in your life, the living wage alone might not be enough. And we heard a great deal about the benefits system, the UK Westminster benefits system, and actually very positive things about the Scottish social security system. So I think the living wage is hugely important, but it's not the only thing.
Okay.
Jerry? Sure. So, There's some confusing terminology about here, so I'll just rehearse briefly some of this. So the living wage in Scotland is a voluntary sort of sign-up scheme that most public sector agencies are either engaged with or sort of working towards. The minimum wage is what regulates all wages in the economy, and that comes from the UK Parliament, and that has been recently rebadged as a living wage, but it's at a slightly lower level than the Scottish living wage. So just to be clear which living wage we're talking about in different circumstances, it's very much needed and it needs to be higher because the majority of people in poverty at the moment are in work poverty. So either that's because wages aren't high enough or people aren't getting enough hours, or their work's precarious, so people are in and out of work or they're not getting the hours every week that they need. And then, of course, the other points that Claire alluded to, that the people who are out of work that, you know, living wage doesn't necessarily impact on. So it is a complicated picture, but it's certainly a very important part of the mix to reduce income inequalities in the country.
Thank you. Evelyn.
Thanks, convener. Sorry, I was just waiting for my mic to come on. I'm really interested in what David Walsh had to say in his opening statement about how we deal with health inequalities. And I want to ask David, does he think it would make any difference if we had an overall national strategy to reduce health inequalities, given that we don't have overall powers for social security, taxation and employment?
Well, I'm at risk of repeating what I said. So I think a strategy would be great in the sense of focusing minds on the importance of the issue and what we can do about it. But fundamentally, if the aim is about narrowing health inequalities across society, then, as I said before, you need the relevant powers. So it's difficult. I mean, this kind of goes back to the last question as well about, you know, at what levels you do these things. And I would refer people to that Health Scotland report from a few years ago, because it was really helpful in laying out the three layers, the three levels that policies are needed at, the kind of fundamental socioeconomic causes, all the wider environmental issues, and then individual experiences of inequalities and the kind of things that Claire was referring to. So a strategy would be great, as I say, in focusing minds, but it does come down to that balance of what we can do versus what's not in our control. And as I said at the beginning, I think there's a need for honesty about what we can do under the current circumstances. Sorry, that's just a repeat of what I said before, but it's basically the same question, same answer.
Thanks, David. So even if we did have an overall strategy, we would struggle to get on top of inequalities if we didn't have those devolved powers, and maybe Westminster actually looking at austerity in an overall UK level way?
Yeah, so I'd emphasise again, this isn't about my personal opinion, this is me just pointing to the published evidence. So the evidence about, as I've said before, if you want to narrow health inequalities, you have to address those fundamental socioeconomic causes of health inequalities. And so therefore you look at what powers do we my camera's just gone haywire. So what powers do we have to address those particular fundamental causes? And as I said before, there's things we can do, there's things we have done. But again, it's that balance of, if you don't have power over certain areas, what can you do? Employment legislation is a decent example of this. So even prior to the current cost of living crisis, some of the biggest increases in poverty levels were among those employed, so in-work poverty. And that relates to all sorts of issues that you know about in terms of zero-hour contracts, the gig economy, all these kind of things. But we can't really do very much about that because employment legislation is entirely reserved. So there's one important area. Social security is a massive area. Social security should be a safety net to help people when they are in difficulty, not something that with which we punish people, which is basically what the UK government has done in terms of aspects of austerity around conditionality of benefits, etc. So, yeah, it's about big amounts of taxation, not just income taxation, but taxing wealth and assets, corporate taxation, all these things with which you can distribute income a bit more. It's about protecting the poorest through a proper, helpful, protective social security system. It's about employment legislation. As I've said already, that's where in Scotland we get into difficulty because we only have very small parts of that that we can affect.
Carol, do you have a question?
Hi, yeah, I just wanted to be clear. You know, thanks very much for David Free's contribution, and I wholeheartedly agree in terms of austerity. But just want to be clear that it is about that the current situation with the current government in Westminster around austerity has had these effects. Of course, in Scotland, we have very different powers and we can use them in very different ways. And we could do that differently depending on what policies we're coming forward to is from the UK. So, you know, I just wanted to ask you, you know, in terms of, you know, if different policies were happening across the UK, could that be helpful for us in Scotland? And then we would be making alternative situations here in Scotland as well.
Yeah, 100%. That's what I said at the end of my opening statement. I said that, you know, we won't narrow health inequalities either without additional powers around those economic areas or if there's a change of policy direction at the UK level. So if austerity hadn't happened at the UK level, then we wouldn't be having these conversations, I don't think, about the horrific scale of increasing death rates among poorer communities. We wouldn't have all the issues around or aspects of food banks and homelessness and all the rest that has been put in published research. So that's the reality about where the economic powers around those fundamental socioeconomic causes lie. So if Westminster takes a different direction, then that would have an effect on Scotland, certainly.
Thank you. Gillian Mackay.
On the sort of whole systems approach that we've been talking about, should we be embedding work to tackle health inequalities across all statutory services rather than just health? And to what extent does the panel believe that this is currently happening or not?
On that. And that comes really, I think, to the heart of the matter of our inquiry, Gillian, if I may say so. Can I maybe go to Jerry first of all?
So I think the short answer to your question is yes. So all public services and indeed other services provided by, you know, other providers make a contribution to the things that make populations healthy or unhealthy. So whether that's police services, housing, or health services. So they all matter and they all make a contribution. And they all need to provide those services in accordance to the level of needs that people have. So there's a great cartoon that I might try and describe that if you have an equal approach to systems and you have three people of different heights and they're trying to look over a wall, that equality doesn't help everybody see over the wall, but an equitable approach obviously has the biggest box for the shortest person so everybody can see over the wall equally. So that's a kind of visual representation of proportionate universalism that Claire talked through. And to a degree, all services need to be sensitive to this. And that's really difficult when you're running services that are facing sort of overwhelming needs at the moment. So health services, for example, have got this massive backlog following the pandemic of unmet need in the system. And that's really difficult. People are really stressed. They're really tired. They're still working, you know, in difficult circumstances with people still being off sick and such like. And so trying to add in that sort of equity duty and try to help people manage waiting lists and manage demand and need in a way that's very sensitive to that is really challenging because, as kind of Claire's alluded to, in some ways, if somebody doesn't turn up to an appointment, that's great, that's one off your list. But of course, those are the people who need that system most. And so the temptation to kind of reduce your waiting list or reduce the seen demand in the system in those ways, I give a health service example, but this applies equally to pretty much every other system that we have. So we need to kind of resist those temptations. And it's almost the people that don't turn up, that, you know, decline appointments, that don't respond, they're the ones in greatest needs. It's the unseen people who you need to have the most sensitivity towards and make the biggest efforts to try and encompass. I used to be a doctor, a proper doctor, if you like, and I did 6 months in psychiatry. And I'm going to tell you a very short story, but it's horrific and it embarrasses me, but I want to illustrate sort of some of the problems of this. So when I was on call for a horrifically long shift over a weekend, and we saw people who were perhaps intoxicated but needed some sort of psychiatric assessment, the way of us managing that demand was to give them an appointment for 9 a.m. on a Monday morning, knowing full well that they wouldn't turn up. And I'm so ashamed that I was part of that system, and I hope and I don't think it would happen now. But that's the kind of thing we just need to eradicate from all our public services, is to make sure that actually those people who need the system most get the best access.
Okay. Claire, would you want to come in on this?
Yes,
Claire's thing is his mic. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I think that's an important question. I mean, I think we heard a lot over the last 2 days at events about stigma and discrimination in services, and I found that shocking, and I suppose I hear a lot of that sort of thing from our member organisations, but I found that very shocking. And you know, somebody said that, you know, that there is nothing in terms of sort of resources or anything that would stop and prevent our public services being more compassionate. So yes, we know services are hugely under stress. Workforces have been through the pandemic and everything else that's going on, so it is very difficult. But there is something, I think there's something at one level about, you know, what is the art of the doable, and having as read services that focus on people's right to health and that are non-discriminatory and that are non-stigmatising, I think is really important and something that could be done. In terms of progress in relation to policy and legislation and opportunities there, I mean, I think things like the Good Food Nation Bill that is going through just now, we're in danger of missing opportunities there, I think, in terms of what could be done in relation to people's access to healthy food and the food environment and the obesogenic environment that some people live in. There's also a public health bill that will be forthcoming, the national planning framework for. These are all some of them are health related, but they're not, you know, they'll be scrutinised by committees other than this one, if there's influence this committee can have in relation to the outcomes of those particular pieces of legislation. That would be very welcome.
It comes back to I think our general health committee ethos is that we think that every portfolio should have a health aspect in it, because quite a lot of the drivers of health inequalities don't actually sit in the health portfolio. And I guess that was shown. I mean, you just have to talk about transport, for example, and quite a lot of the people that we spoke to on Friday and Monday talked about the cost of transport, and it was the biggest thing for them, or the cost of food, you know, and that was having an impact on their health and their ability to access services as well. I don't know if David Walsh wants to come in on Gillian Mackay's question or...
Nothing specific to add. I mean, as researchers, we're forever coming out with recommendations, and I remember a previous large report we produced, we had a lot of recommendations about using this sort of World Health Organization's approach to health in all policies. And so yeah, we would sign up to that. But as Jerry's alluded to, you know, it's one thing, the rhetoric is one thing in pressed services in that kind of environment. Doing it is another. There's also issues about, you know, the socio-economic duty on councils to always look to issues about what impact their policies have on poverty, etc. So these are all really good things. It's the practical aspects of embedding them in everyday managing of policy and services that's the issue.
Yeah. Gillian, you want to come back in?
Very briefly. We've obviously been talking about income a lot. To what extent would the panel support a universal basic income or a minimum income guarantee or something like that as a way of as a way of tackling some of that income inequality and therefore the health inequalities that result.
Jerry.
So I need to declare a couple of interests first. So I chaired the Scottish Citizens Basic Income Feasibility Study, and I'm on the advisory group, I think it's called, for the minimum income guarantee work. So with those hats sort of on or off, I think a UBI is a really promising intervention because it could move more people out of poverty and reduce the precarity in people's income streams and allow people the kind of the security, the income security to thrive. But there are a number of risks to the policy and there are a number of considerations about how it would be financed. And so we had recommended that it be piloted, but we don't yet have the cooperation of the necessary UK agencies to allow that sort of piloting to take place. So on that basis, looking at a minimum income guarantee, so using the existing powers within Scotland to sort of shore up the holes in to shore up the holes in the benefit system to ensure people don't fall through the cracks and experience poverty, I think it's a really promising approach that could hopefully reduce the number of people experiencing poverty and all the consequences that has.
Seem to have a gremlin in the room. Someone's speaking to us from beyond. I'm not sure. But we did hear everything that Jerry said. Can I go to Emma? You had a quick question on this before I go to questions from Sandesh Gohani. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. It is just a quick sup to kind of go back to what Evelyn was saying and what Gillian was saying. Rishi Sunak could make changes in policy that would address cost of living crisis, which we're probably going to see exacerbate health inequalities. So, like, national insurance has gone up. We've got people in fuel poverty. We are seeing people choosing between heating and eating. Maybe luckily we've got summer weather coming now. Universal credit being removed or like a portion of the uplift was taken away. So what is the barrier for the finance secretary for like making a windfall tax or actually addressing some of these issues? Why is it a political issue or is it just, I mean, what are the constraints?
Jerry?
So, yeah, these are all political choices, if we're honest. So if you look at so inflation's not unique to the UK or to Scotland. It's happening across many, many countries, sparked by, you know, higher oil prices, gas prices, food prices, and different countries are taking different approaches. So I gather in Germany, for example, the costs of public transport have been slashed partly to reduce people's demand for oil and cars, to have spin-off benefits for people's incomes as a result, and environmental, positive environmental consequences by reducing car travel. So that's just one very specific example of the kinds of variety of approaches that we're seeing across the world. So each country, you know, and each administration will make their own choices about this, but it's ultimately a question of priorities. And I think if the cost of living and the inflation costs that people are facing is not addressed by policy, then it will have massive consequences for the real experience of poverty, and as a result will have real consequences for people's health. And the trends that David has described in such detail around the rising mortality for our poorest communities, that will get worse, and it will get worse faster if these challenges aren't addressed properly.
David Finch would like to come in. I'll bring David in.
Sure, thank you. I mean, I was initially going to comment on the UBI thing, but I mean, on the cost of living crisis, as Jerry was saying, it does come down to choices, and we saw through the pandemic that it is possible to put into place some quite significant support at relatively short notice. And I guess a concern of ours would be the kind of the remaining resilience of families as well, where they've already gone through the pandemic, and lower income households in particular are more likely to build up debts through that period. So then coming into a kind of cost of living crisis where they're also likely to face
lower income households are likely to face the higher inflation rates. The kind of knock-on health impacts of that are a significant concern. But I think the point is it's something that is that can be tackled through all the extra support to help cope with that is something that can be tackled through sort of increased government support, whether it's through the benefit system, particularly, which would be the kind of quickest route to get support to lower income households.
Thank you, David. Can I go to questions from Sandesh Gohani? Sandesh.
Thank you, convener. So I was just wanted to talk a little bit about evidence, data and successes that we have. So was it Scotland have said that we need far more robust data? And there seems to be a theme that runs throughout health. We just need far more robust data on long-standing health inequalities. And you know, when I was training at medical school back in 2000, Glasgow was used as a place of great inequality. This was back in 2000. So what are the data gaps that we have and how can we step up, how can Scottish Government step up to try and fill in this information so that we can get more robust data?
So there are different types of data, obviously. I think Claire's articulated very vividly sort of qualitative data and the importance of lived experience. And I think there's much more we can and should do to gather and feed that into policymaking. But in terms of quantitative data and monitoring, Scotland has the best monitoring system in the world, bar none, for monitoring trends in health inequalities. So every year, in March this year, the Scottish Government published the long-term monitoring report on health inequalities, which is simply outstanding in terms of the detail it goes into, in terms of overall mortality trends by different groups and the different trends for specific causes of death, well-being measures, a whole range of things. It's a thoroughly good and clear read, and it undertakes a series of statistical analyses to look at gradients, gap measures, the absolute trends as well. So I think we need to keep those really high quality data systems that we have in place. So I wouldn't say that the problems we have in Scotland are in any way related to gaps in data. However, as a researcher and somebody from a university, we'll always want more. So there are gaps, for example, around understanding the health of ethnic minorities, gypsy travellers, other equality groups. And there are means by which we could get that through linkages of, for example, the census with health records. That has been done previously. So the Scottish Health and Ethnicity Linkage Studies, the SHEL study, led by Raj Bhopal, did that in the past, and that uncovered a lot of interesting statistics about the differential experiences of different groups within Scotland. So, for example, in that we learned that white Scots had lower life expectancy than all the other ethnic minorities, but hospitalisation rates for some specific things were higher for some of our ethnic minority groups. So we could do more of that routinely, and we could also do more around individual measures of socioeconomic position, for example, occupational social class or educational attainment or income. So in the past, we've looked at trying to encourage parliamentarians to include income questions in the census. That has always been seen as too controversial, but actually that would fill a massive missing gap in what we currently know about the experience of inequalities of all sorts in Scotland. It would also be ideal if we could get linkage to DWP and HMRC data. So we've been asking for this linkage for more than a decade now, and we still don't have this linkage. And that means that we can't do individual level studies on the whole population of the impacts of things like sanctions policies on benefits. We have to rely on some of the panel surveys we have, like Understanding Society, which take a sample of the population and allow us to look at those impacts. But we could look at that in a much more local level if we had that full data linkage. And indeed, the Digital Economy Act, a UK Act, should facilitate some of that, but we're still finding a number of administrative barriers to actually accessing the data and doing those studies.
David Walsh would like to come in, if I can bring David in from remotely.
Not for the first time. Jerry's just said what I was about to say. I had three points, and then after saying I wanted to come in, Jerry then addressed all three of them. But just in response to, and to echo what Jerry said in response to the question, the issue isn't to do with the data. The issue is the horrific things that the data are showing. And it's important you realise that, I think.
Sandesh.
Yeah, and just looking, so Gerry, you talked about minimum unit pricing as a marker of success. There is a bit of controversy about the success of minimum alcohol pricing, how good it's been, and also whether increasing it or not would make a difference. And I'd be interested to know a bit more from yourself.
So in my previous job, I was heavily involved in the minimum unit pricing studies, and they're still underway. So we have really strong theoretical evidence that this will have a positive effect and an equalising effect. And the early studies do look to show that it is having a positive effect and it is being equalising in terms of mortality and hospitalisations. But those definitive studies will be reported to Parliament before the end of the sunset clause, and you know that will be the definitive point to make that judgment. What I think you're alluding to is about the level of MUP. So what was set in the original legislation has eroded with inflation over time. So the number of products that would have been affected has decreased over time. So the effectiveness of the policy might not have kept up with prices. So arguably, it could or should be index linked or increased at least to try and remove those high strength cheap sources of alcohol and keep them out of the system, because they are the most damaging to people's health.
I don't know if anyone else would like to come in on this. Claire?
Could I come in on the previous question?
Of course you can.
Which was the one about data, but where largely I agree entirely with Gerry, but I suppose just to add that, you know, third sector is a source of very rich qualitative data, and it's not taken up and used by any means to the extent that which it could be and made useful. So I suppose that is one sort of point, one point to make. But I think there's also a question about access to data as well. So who gets access to data and how that's used? And again, I think for our sector, if there was better access to data, sometimes we would be able to develop responses and approaches and services better. And then I think there are data gaps in relation perhaps more to the types of health inequalities that relate to service provision. And I'm thinking of a particular example, and it is work that Voluntary Health Scotland has been doing for a number of years now with mental health charities and the Mental Health Welfare Commission, and in fact Audit Scotland and the Care Inspectorate were involved as well, looking at the inequalities that people with serious mental health conditions like schizophrenia and bipolar condition face when they reach 65. Because for some people, they're then moved into geriatric, as it's called, mental health services, and they lose things like their community psychiatric nurse. They're overlooked, they become missing in terms of the services that are available. And we have been frustrated in our ability to get policymakers to take this serious as an issue, because there isn't data. And we had NHS Health Scotland Knowledge Services, when NHS Health Scotland was still around, help us do literature reviews and look at this. The data on older people's mental health simply isn't gathered. So there are, and that's just one example. And I think, again, across the third sector, you would find, because a lot of charities will work on single issues or with a particular sort of population group or groups with particular conditions. So I think from our sector's point of view, the data isn't necessarily always there that would help actually back up what organisations and services experience in practice on the ground, but then haven't got the data in order to make the case to advocate for policy change. Thank you.
Can I bring in David Walsh?
Yeah, it was just to go back to the first question, which is about alcohol minimum unit pricing, sorry. It's just the question related to the controversial aspect of it. And I think what the questioner was alluding to was an output from a right-wing think tank, which had coverage in, I think, the Daily Mail about this not being an effective policy. And I think it's quite important to say that that wasn't really evidence-based at all. And all the robust evidence from modelling and all the work that Health Scotland has since done is that this is an effective policy. But as Gerry alluded to, the level of the price level is what's important, whether that needs to go up. But I don't think it's a controversial policy on the basis of all the evidence and the robust evidence that's been produced.
And can I bring in David Finch? Can I bring in David Finch first of all, and I'll come back to you.
Sure, sorry. And I'm jumping back to the data point. Sorry,
move between them. I agree with what other people said, and particularly the administrative data point, where we've had research for funding with the University of Glasgow that's been waiting for 3 years to get a data linkage with DWP data to link to drugs and drug and alcohol death data, which is frustrating. But I think the wider point I was going to make is just about the a strand of the research within our review is looking at the kind of data that is available and the potential gaps there. And I think, although admittedly, as I think David Walsh said, there's already a comprehensive report published on health trends. But I think one thing in particular they're doing is speaking to people who use the data and more practitioners about just whether it about the presentation and how they interpret it and whether it quite suits their needs, which I think is links slightly to I think the point that's been made about the voluntary sector. So that's something that we'll be very happy to share when they've finished that element of the work.
Okay. Thank you very much. Sandesh, you wanted to get a comment before we move on to questions from Emma Harper?
Yeah, I think it's very important that people don't put words into the mouths of the questions. I was asking a question. I certainly was not referring to a right-wing think tank, and I don't think that was very appropriate.
Make points that they want. Emma, I am going to ask on human rights issues as well, but I'm going to leave that to end because I've got my colleagues want to come in on some quite substantive issues. Can I go to health and inequalities impact assessments? Mm-hmm. Emma, you want to ask some questions on that, and I'll come to Paul Keane on COVID-19.
Sure, thanks. I will be pretty quick, actually. In our private sessions, one of the persons that was giving us information said that equality impact assessments are not being made routinely in planning, for instance, and thinks that a wider engagement of thinking about how people access services needs to be considered as well. So wondering if you've got any thoughts about how equalities impact assessments could be done better in order to support tackling health inequalities.
Yeah,
I can
see you nodding along.
Yes, first. I think I meant to mention health inequality impact assessments in my opening statement and forgot to. So I would be interested to know the extent to which health inequalities impact assessments are used already, and I haven't been able to find that out. So if the committee were able to find that out, I think that would be interesting and important, because ostensibly, I mean, certainly we would say if health inequalities impact assessments could be used routinely across the board in decision making and planning, whether that's through the national planning framework structure, for example, but other types of decisions as well, any kind of decisions across public services or public policy, public decision making, we would think that would be a kind of an easy thing that could at least be done. But of course, the danger is it becomes a tick box exercise. But I have no evidence really of the extent to which impact assessments are used and how and whether they have been used successfully. So other colleagues on the panel might have better answers than I on that. But certainly in principle, yes, we would support greater use of them.
And do we have anyone else want to come in on the equality impact assessments at all? I won't press you if you don't want to come in, but Jerry?
So my recommendation would be, if you're really interested in this, to speak to Margaret Douglas at the University of Edinburgh, who's kind of Scotland's lead expert on all things impact assessments. She would be your source of knowledge.
Thank you for that recommendation. And certainly with regard to Claire's question, it's a question that we have as well. And it does strike me, if you do an equality impact assessment, it can save you problems further down the line when you launch projects and put policies into action. Emma?
Yeah, I think obviously down the line in our inquiry, we might have more clarity on equality impact assessments and how they are used. So, and Claire's already said that you would support that further use of equality impact assessments as well. So I would be interested in just hearing the thoughts on whether you think it should be a requirement for public sector organisations just to conduct health equality impact assessments. And that way we would have health as part of every portfolio then.
In principle, we would support that. And indeed, in our response to the consultation on the National Planning Framework, for example, that was the main thing that we called for. And we are not experts in planning. It was a very difficult consultation for us to get to grips with. But that seemed like a very clear ask that we could make. So yes, in principle, but again, with the caveats that, you know, if it's made a duty, then it has to be a meaningful duty. And I suppose that needs to be backed up with sort of training and understanding on the part of decision makers and services as to what it actually means, so that it's a meaningful exercise and not just a tick box exercise.
Thank you. David Finch wants to come in on this. David?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to add that we have a programme of work called that we call Economies for Healthier Lives, which is thinking about how economic development can be used to help improve health. And one of those projects is with Glasgow City Region and led by Jane Thompson with Glasgow City Council. And that is effectively looking at how developing a capital investment health inequalities impact assessment tool, and it's really exploring how that can get first the design of it and also how it can be embedded at the different stages of capital investment projects. So I think that is potentially something that can we'll be able to give you some more information about maybe some of the challenges in doing that and the effectiveness of doing it as well.
Thank you. Emma, can I go move on now?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Come to questions on the impact of COVID-19. No Health Committee would be the same without that line of questioning. Over to Paul Kane.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. Yeah, I mean, I think that we can't escape COVID. We've lived 2 years of pandemic. A lot of the call for evidence submissions reflected the COVID experience. I think actually our informal evidence sessions over the past few days, a lot of the conversation has been dominated by COVID and by the impact that's had and the barriers, I think, that that's created to people improving their health. I suppose maybe the first question is, what has been the biggest impact? We've obviously seen an impact in terms of people's physical health, their ability to get out and about and access healthcare and things like exercise. But we've also seen a number of policy initiatives designed to tackle health inequalities paused or deprioritised. I mean, is it too early to say what the impact of both of those things have been and perhaps what's been the most serious impact?
So if I understand the question correctly, it's kind of thinking in the round about the impacts of the pandemic. So I'd refer the committee to a paper that actually Margaret Douglas, who I referred to earlier, led on, that was published in the BMJ early on in the pandemic, where we did actually a health impact assessment of the unintended consequences of physical distancing measures. So clearly there are the direct impacts of COVID, so the mortality, the morbidity, the long COVID that people experience. And then there are the plethora of indirect impacts, some of which are healthcare related, so the postponement of healthcare services or people not coming forward, expressing needs for healthcare services. And then through a range of other things, so people's jobs changing, people's experience of education changing, people's experience of childcare changing, people being stuck in the house, potentially with abusers, transport changes. So we saw a massive decline in road travel with really positive impacts on air pollution for a time. We saw reallocation of road space towards active travel for a time in some areas. Some places have retained that, other places have removed that. People's finances changed, so some people were able to save, largely the middle classes. Other people had their incomes reduced, who were perhaps already in precarious employment, maybe couldn't access the furlough scheme. So that's a complicated set of pathways. The net impact, of course, has seen a rise in mortality and a rise in mortality inequalities that peaked, previously. Things have improved since the worst aspects of the pandemic. And a lot of that was direct COVID mortality, but actually we saw a rise in indirect mortality as well from other causes, and we're not as clear about just quite what's behind that. So some of it might be coding issues where, COVID's a contributing factor, but it's not recorded in the process of looking at people's journey. It might be through these other factors, people losing jobs, stress. It could now be the cost of living crisis and the cumulative effects of austerity. So disentangling that and sort of attributing, you know, what aspects of the round COVID experience had on specific health experiences is difficult. But I suppose the worry that I have is that if we return to the economic policies that we saw prior to the pandemic, then we can't expect the improvement that we've seen to continue. It will go back to the same flat line that we saw from 2012 onwards. And although we've talked a lot about mortality, actually healthy life expectancy has been declining for that period. So people's, when you combine mortality experience with people's self-reported health, that's been getting worse since 2012. So I think that's the worry, that that continues in that trajectory.
Claire?
Yeah, it's hard to add to Jerry, so I don't want to repeat. I mean, I suppose on top of all of that, the worry, I suppose, in our sector now, as expressed over the last probably sort of 6 months or so, as things get back to a bit more of normality, is that people are still on very long waiting lists for health care, and are still having difficulty in terms of accessing health care, but also other services within communities still haven't opened up fully. So some third sector organisations can't reopen, you know, lunch clubs and daycare and things like that, because public sector community centres still aren't open in some cases. On Good Morning Scotland this morning, they were talking about swimming pools for children in Glasgow still not open. So I think there's those sort of wider impacts that do impact on people's health. And Voluntary Health Scotland just yesterday was a signature, along with Versus Arthritis, the charity Versus Arthritis, to the Cabinet Secretary for Health, specifically about waiting lists, hospital waiting lists. For the letter was specifically about elective care, but I think it goes wider than that. But one of the things the third sector has been looking at, so organisations like Versus Arthritis and British Red Cross, has been what can our sector do to support people to wait well, because things are not back to normal, and you have people who've got all sorts of medical needs, health needs that are not being met through the NHS for all sorts of reasons. But what can our sector do to support people to actually self-manage, to manage, you know, the mental distress about that, and to wait well, as the phrase. But yes, thank you.
I wonder if I can. So I think that's very helpful in terms of that broader context. And I think the important part of any COVID inquiry has to be looking in quite laser focus in a lot of these issues, and to try and then understand the impact and effect. I wonder if I can get a sense of, and I suppose, Claire, you've alluded to some of this already, but there were some kind of unintended positives almost that came out of the pandemic, and that was probably about communities coming together in a way that they hadn't before, voluntary health organisations in particular really stepping up. How do we measure that, and how do we protect that going forward? Because I think we would want to see investment in those sorts of softer services that have made the difference for people.
Really interesting point. Yes, I mean, I think the community sector and the voluntary sector did sort of step up and aim to fill that gap when there were lockdowns and other services weren't necessarily available. I think what's interesting in terms of sort of positive outcomes is that the voluntary sector has had to change a lot of what it does. So in terms of making services available via telephone or via digital internet, which didn't happen anything like to the extent that it does now. A lot of organisations are now doing both, because for some clients, for some service users, for some people, it actually works. It works better for them, or works as well. So I think a positive outcome has been that there's more options and choice for some people in relation to certainly third sector services. In terms of funding, I think we saw, not least actually Scottish Government, but a lot of independent funders as well, they made funds available quickly to the voluntary sector so that the voluntary sector could pivot, that was the word that was being used, could pivot from its normal services to do whatever was needed to reach out to people and support them. and that funding was very welcome. And I think also funders flexed existing requirements on existing funding that had already been allocated. So there was a lot of flexibility. And what we hear now from our members is that, you know, a lot of that, the old bureaucracy is creeping back in terms of those sort of relationships. So I suppose one of the things we would want to see is that spirit of partnership and of trust of the voluntary sector. You know, we were trusted to get on with it and deliver in times of deep lockdowns. So can we not be trusted now to carry on with that? And yes, you know, you've alluded yourself to the need for sustainable funding. So emergency funding, short-term funding has been very welcome, but longer-term, our sector still faces enormous difficulties in terms of sustainable funding and not lurching from, you know, one short-term funding package to another. So something in relation to funding would be very welcome, but actually flexibility in terms of bureaucracy also goes a long way.
Thank you.
I said I was going to leave human rights to the very end because it's actually gone through quite a lot of what we've been talking about. And human right to live your life well, I guess, is fundamental. We, again, talking about conversations which three out of four of you have not been party to in terms of our informal evidence sessions, very difficult, so I won't put out specifics there. But it struck me in speaking to people seeking asylum that we spoke to, people who were advocating for family members and friends in prison. We heard about gypsy travellers. We heard about people with no recourse to public funds. The thread that was going through a lot of the conversations having with them is that they don't feel that they're getting access to the basic human rights. And I wanted to ask, what would a human rights approach to tackling these structural inequalities actually look like, and what specific interventions could be made in order to make human rights the thread that runs through absolutely delivery of all our services, regardless of whether people have got recourse to public funds or not, whoever that is in society in Scotland, what would that actually look like? Huge question. You can see why I left it to the end. But I'd like to know. I'm particularly struck by what people told me about a prison population not getting access to healthcare, not getting access to their medication, even though they've got chronic health conditions when they go in prison or come out of prison. That was going to stay with me for a long time, and blew my mind, frankly. So there's other people that feel that they're not getting access to healthcare that are from marginalised communities. So would you think there could be interventions in making sure that those people do get access to the healthcare?
That is a really enormous question. I think one of the things that did come through from those informal sessions was that people didn't know that they had a right to health. So that perhaps needs to be one of the starting points. So why do people not know that they have a right to health? And in fact, the work that we published for the Inclusion Health Partnership earlier this year, which was looking at the experiences of COVID amongst marginalised populations. The strong message that came through that as well was that people didn't know they had a right to health. They didn't know they had a right to a GP, for example. So there's something about making, and maybe a targeted approach again, in the way that actually there have been targeted approaches in relation to gypsy traveller populations in terms of helping them to understand they have a right to register with a GP, for example. So targeted approach to helping people to understand their rights. But I suppose the flip side of that is that service providers, decision makers, all of us, and I would include the third sector in that, not just public sector, and actually I suppose private sector as well, you know, everybody, wherever you are out in the real world, there needs to be, I suppose, education and training for anybody who's providing a public service of any kind, what people's rights are. So I think those would be my two things that I would focus on. Jerry will know more about this, I'm sure, but there's different frameworks and toolkits and things like the panel principles and the AAA framework and those sort of things that I think would help public services, workforces and public services to understand how to embed a more human rights approach. But I think that the starting point, if you've got people understanding they have a right to health, and other rights as well, rights, human rights. That has to be a step forward.
Thank you. Can I come to David Walsh? Oh, we'll just unmute David Walsh, please.
Sorry, I was just waiting for the microphone to come on. So just to point you to, there were people in Health Scotland, before it became Public Health Scotland, who were looking at a human rights approach in relation to inequality. So it might be worth speaking to them in terms of how that work developed. More generally, and just returning again to the evidence about how you address broader health inequalities, I've talked before about those three levels that have been identified as being important. And the third of those was about individual experiences of inequalities. And that talked about particularly targeting people at high risk, so children in care, the homeless. But to that list, I would add the groups that you've mentioned in terms of prisoner population and asylum seekers. And asylum seekers also brings you in back to the whole politics of it all, in terms of the way that asylum seekers and people seeking refuge in this country are currently being treated and discussed. And I don't need to say much more about that. But it also comes, I think, again, back to the issue of what I've talked about quite a lot, which is social security. So having a social security system as a human right, in terms of a system there to protect those in times of need, and rather than a system that I think has been rather attacked in recent times. So I think it all is a huge question, but I think it ties back into a lot of the themes that have come through this conversation this morning.
Thank you. Jenny, I don't know if you've got anything to add to that.
I'll be brief. So the groups that you discussed all have very high needs, and we need services that are built around those needs and built in collaboration, deep collaboration with those groups. They don't lend themselves to place-based approaches, which is why sometimes we need to actually to find those equity groups, those groups with high needs or different needs, groups that might not find it easy to access services that aren't designed around them. And so we need to think about how we meet those needs differently. And every public service, and indeed other services that aren't provided by the public sector, need to think about that. So it also speaks to power inequalities that I mentioned at the very start. So these are all groups that are, in one way or other, made powerless, either by dint of being relatively small compared to majority populations, or because they are silenced in some way or other. And I guess the prison population is a classic example of that. So the reaction in some arms of the media when we think about even giving prisoners the vote means that even at the very basic level of hearing the voices and the needs of particular groups, we're not able to hear that. And it's maybe a shout out to think about different models of democracy. So we've seen more participatory methods used to discuss where there are trickier issues and where there are particular groups that are more affected. And that's perhaps something that could be considered where we're designing services for high-risk groups like this. So I probably shouldn't refer to it as high-risk groups with greater needs as a better way of framing it.
Thank you. I'm going to round off the session. Thank you so much for the time that the four of you have spent with us this morning. Very, very interesting, and a very good start to what's going to be hopefully a very important and interesting inquiry, with some recommendations at the end of it, which we must always remember. So thank you very much for your time. At our next meeting on the 31st of May, we will continue taking evidence as part of this inquiry into health inequalities, focusing on the impact of the pandemic on health inequalities and the work to tackle them. But that does conclude the public part of our meeting today. Thank you.